Anyway, I just would say a couple of things. I was thinking about this question of strategy versus tactics and the problem of pragmatism, because that's what you hear. LaRouche keeps attacking when he says, when someone says, let's be practical, that they should be taken out to the woodshed. And there are a couple examples. One, on a smaller scale, I don't know how many people saw the film Apollo 13 or followed it when it was unfolding, where we almost lost the entire crew because they were going to run out of oxygen. And they had to figure out a way. What turned out is one of the parts that had broken, they didn't have a replacement. And basically, they had to fit a round hose into a square thing. And so you have the support team down on Earth knowing that if they don't solve this problem, these people are going to die. We're just going to lose them. And see, Americans, the reason why the Russians and other nations are so eager to have us on their missions is we have the best success rate when we fund our space program, because we actually place a very high level on the value of the lives of our citizens, and we want our missions to succeed, and we don't consider people expendable. We don't say, oops, well, we lost one there, we lost six people, but that's not too bad. We have 320 million Americans, so we'll just try it again. That is not acceptable in the United States. So what happens is, the way they show it in the movie is the guys on the ground know exactly what's on the spaceship. Duct tape and this piece and that piece. So they bring all this stuff in on a table and they say, here it is, you figure out how to solve this. So you have this team on the ground frantically scrambling, doing this, that, because the guys in the space don't have time to experiment. Plus they're trying to like stay still and not do things and, you know, not deplete their energy and oxygen or whatever they have to use. So the people on the ground don't have a choice. They either solve this problem or these people die. And they came up with something, thank God, that worked. Now, I raise that because what you get with these stupid questions at the beginning of each webcast lately is basically whoever's asking them is completely ignoring what LaRouche is saying, which is that either Obama leaves office or we don't have a guarantee. There is no way to guarantee that we don't have thermonuclear war, because everything this guy has done indicates, if you look at Kerry's performance in Syria, it is satanic. It's unbelievable. He might as well be the Queen of England expressing his, you know, whatever. It's outrageous. No respect for the sovereignty of Syria whatsoever, making demands that Assad has to go no matter what. You can't do that in negotiations. So with Obama in office, we are headed for thermonuclear war, period. So this person never wants to discuss that question. It's like saying, well, okay, so I know that there is a comet heading towards the Earth at, you know, 360,000 miles per nanosecond, and we're all going to be destroyed. But why don't we discuss what's going to happen in the next elections? I think I have a question of, can we come up with a tactic of how the Democratic Party can win the next elections? And, right, because they've just decided that we cannot stop the comet, therefore we can't even think about it, we're not going to address it, we're going to go along with this. And that's the issue of, and every time you hear someone say, let's be practical, then you know the thing that's the thought bubble or what precedes that is that since we can't actually do what is necessary, we will do this thing that will not accomplish anything. But we know we can do it. So let's do that so we all feel good about ourselves, because everyone knows you don't want to put too much pressure on yourself, because then you might be being authoritarian if you say that you have to do something. So at any rate, I think this is key. Now, I raise that because the other thing I was thinking about a lot recently was Neil Gallagher, who some people know, the congressman who was in Congress from 59 to 72, who was very close friends with Kennedy, and who sent this statement to the first Kennedy Requiem. He's now 92 years old and very sharp. And then at the town hall meeting we had for my campaign, he and Lynn were on the phone together. And he said to Lynn, he said, you know, basically our nation wouldn't exist without you. That your voice has been so important, I don't think we would be here if you didn't exist. And that's not to say I agree with everything you've said, but you are the conscience of the United States. And I was very struck by that, because what Lynn had said to the policy committee in our discussion this past Monday, which was raised again in the webcast, was he said, immortality is not that someone says nice things about you after you're dead. Right? That is not immortality. I will say very nice things about my dog after my dog is dead. But immortality is that your person, your mind, actually continues to be productive when your body is no longer here, when your body is dead and gone. And you can think about this event we just did with Mozart and Kennedy. Mozart had a profound effect on everybody in that room, and it's quite some time since he has been physically dead, as did Kennedy. And it's not just the memories, but it's a real transformation where the people who engage in that can become better people and can act to change the future for mankind. And so that's what LaRouche actually represents. And that's how also people become immortal while they are still alive. Because it's something that you are causing, a change that you are causing, which is not necessarily measured in sense perceptual, you know, things that you can weigh or smell or whatever. Anyway, so I think that's very much worth thinking about, because what we have before us, and I'm really glad that Bob is doing this class, because this whole period where Lynn is now going back to the assassination of Lincoln, the Civil War, most Americans don't even know what that was. They don't know what it was about, and they don't know what the fight was about afterwards, and they don't really think in terms of this arc. People tend to think, the best that you get from people is they think history began sometime after they started remembering things, so maybe like when they were 5 years old or so. and then it ends once they can't remember things anymore. So that's as opposed to, no, there's a different kind of continuum, and it's interestingly non-linear, because things that happen in a certain time can get covered up by a dark age, like you think about Eratosthenes measuring the circumference of the earth in 332 BC, and then you have an awful lot of bloodshed in the Roman Empire and everything else, but then this gets picked up again by Toscanelli, Nicholas of Cusa, and Columbus, right? So, but it's part of the history of the development of civilization, of mankind. So I think the more that we get ourselves to think that way, the more likely it is that we will all be able to be immortal. And to make sure that we're immortal, we actually do have to win this fight, because I think it would be hard if the entire human species gets exterminated. Then, you know, what happens to Beethoven and Mozart? Who's going to carry that? Who's going to carry these great ideas? So we have to win. We have to win the war, and that requires a new quality of thinking than is normally accepted and is certainly not common in the population. So that's what I have.
All right, so within the next 24 or 48 hours or something like that, you'll all have the wonderful opportunity of studying a 40-page paper, a tour de force strategic paper that LaRouche has just completed. It's being edited. It will be the next EIR magazine. That's what the next EIR is going to be. It's called Sense and Science Again. For those of you that look at the weekly report or follow the discussion of the policy committee, you'll know a little bit about this. I'm simply going to take a few paragraphs toward the end of the paper where he discusses this issue of where we are strategically in history and just read through them. This is under a heading called Now Since Bismarck. Again, this is part of something much larger with much larger issues addressed. But again, it does focus in on this issue of this period of history. And he says, the Lincoln assassination had opened the particular fire which had triggered a new state of warfare, a state of warfare the which had launched the beginning of an actually permanent state of worldwide warfare, which, with the likeness of dinner time breaks, has in fact been effectively continuous from that time to the present one, and still today, awaiting that continued warfare, still on this same present day, I am writing my present report here. For example, grand global warfare with no real peace, but only virtual dinner breaks of a continuous intention from the time of the Lincoln assassination and not yet ended in the present day. On this account, heretofore, the mere high-ranking tacticians participating in this process of a London-launched grand warfare from the time of the Lincoln assassination to beyond this present date of my writing of this report has been in net effect a continuous process up to the moment in which the world as a whole stands waiting until we had reached the present strategic posture for the launching of an essentially thermonuclear global state of engagement, which is now already overripe for its expression, even as early as a few moments' steps from the completion of this my present report here. Perhaps in present history, perhaps with the virtual end of the continued history which threatens to end wars, that done by measures which could even probably mean the extinction of the human species amid the resonant consequences of the outbreak of such a war. World War III, in a still continuing series today, has been passed. But the apparent passing was merely a temporary pit stop now for the immediate lurking outbreak of World War III. Not a world war to bring a merely subsequent, merely ostensible new world war, but a war of virtual human extinction, conducted oh so briefly, under conditions of a virtually global, greatly enhanced form of thermonuclear super warfare, warfare to be expressed in action on one not so bright day, soon, unless the entire shebang is prevented now. Betwixt and between the assassination of President Abraham Lincoln, that war has proceeded above all interim considerations of apparent successions of war or peace, continually under the guise of spurts of killing and of dubious intervals of a merely nominal peace up through the present moment of my writing of this report. So what I want to do over the next hour, I'll try to make this as compact as I can, is kind of give you a way to think about this and how this actually functioned. And I'll throw out a pedagogical thought puzzle, or however you want to think about it, which is there is something radically, aside from the fact that you have the thermonuclear weapons, which nobody was throwing around in 1914, but there's something radically, radically different about this period that we're in as a strategic factor which allows us to get out of this. And you could, as we go through this, you can try to think in your mind, what's the difference between this period that we're about to go through and today? And don't worry, I'll give you the answer at the end. So. Oh, by the way, that's Bismarck. That's, of course, a newspaper. All right, so we're going to quickly, I mean, this could be like a six-hour presentation because you'd want to go through the American Revolution and everything that came out of it and Jackson's attack on the, but we're not going to do that. So what I will say, though, however, is that there is a definitive breaking point with the 50-year process personally organized by was known as the American Prometheus Benjamin Franklin, who was committed his entire life that he was going to create this republic in the continuance of what was initiated by the Massachusetts Bay Colony, which a lot of people here are familiar with. And that reached a definitive breakpoint in history, of course, with the Declaration of Independence, the successful global strategic equation, which Franklin brought into being with the various, you know, the League of Armed Neutrality, the alliance with France, you know, the weighing in of the Russians in a certain way, etc. So this was a global event, creating the Republic. And I always use this quote just because this is John Quincy Adams, who was really the founder of American foreign policy, and really the architect of the creation of what we call the United States today, coast to coast, Atlantic to Pacific, interior development, the whole thing. And this is a speech he gave on the July 4th, 1821. This is not a speech. This is a little teeny part of the speech. I wouldn't even read the little teeny part of it, but he just says, well, in a conflict of 7 years, the history of the war by which you maintain that Declaration of Independence, this has become the history of the civilized world. It was the first solemn declaration by a nation of the only legitimate foundation of civil government. It was the cornerstone of a new fabric destined to cover the surface of the globe. It stands and must forever stand alone, a beacon on the summit of the mountain to which all the inhabitants of the earth may turn their eyes for a genial and saving light, a light of salvation and redemption to the oppressed. Right? So this was the conception. This is not some event that we have here, but this creation of a government, as Lincoln would later say, of the people, by the people, for the people, explicitly with a function, a constitution, with something like Hamilton's National Bank, to allow the development of the peoples of that nation. That was the idea. And I've also shown this before. This is in this exact period of when Quincy Adams said that. You had already had, and this is pretty hubristic, pretty egregious. You know, so here we just have this, we create this nation, this little experiment, we fight and battle it out to beat the British Empire. And before we even have a nation coast to coast, virtually, we're sending people to Thailand, we're sending people to Hawaii, we're sending people to the Middle East, to India, right? And these are all in the form of missionaries, American missionaries, but they're there to spread this, if you will, new gospel of the American Revolution. This map goes up to 1860, so it's all pre-Civil War. And of course, you had a heavy deployment by the British in the form of the backing of this Confederate insurrection to basically bring the whole project down. And we're not going to go through the Civil War here. But it was the Promethean leadership of Lincoln, who was a Shakespeare scholar and a grand master of strategy, who knew these factors globally, strategically, that allowed us to ward off that attempted destruction of the nation. This is the Appomattox surrender of Lee to Lincoln and his generals. And then, of course, Lincoln is assassinated. But what I want to focus on is what comes out of this decisive victory for this form of government and its policies, post-Civil War. Because while the Civil War was going on, Lincoln's initiated in 1863 the building of the Transcontinental Railroad. So the whole idea of defeating the insurrection and you know, because you had a whole bunch of people in the North that wanted to get out of the war. Oh, this is going on too long. Let's just have a negotiated settlement. Union, schmoonion, who cares, you know. And that would have been the death of this form of government that must not perish from the earth. And the means of achieving that, the first blow would be at this transcontinental railroad to unify a one nation under this idea. The Green Line is the first one, which is the Union Pacific Railroad that was completed in 1869. And the top one was initiated immediately after, really starting in a big way in 1873, which was the Northern Pacific Railroad. That's Henry Carey, who was Lincoln's economic strategist, who a lot of people are familiar with here, who was kind of like the grand master of these projects, and then sending people abroad to initiate them. This is the famous quote that we always use. There are two systems before the world, right? One looks to increasing the necessity of commerce, the other to increasing the power to maintain it. One looks to underworking the Hindu and sinking the rest of the world to his level, the other to raise the standard of man throughout the world to our level. One looks to pauperism, ignorance, depopulation, and barbarism. The other in increasing wealth, comfort, intelligence, combination of action, and civilization. One looks toward universal war, the other toward universal peace. One is the English system, the other we may be proud to call the American system, for it's the only one ever devised, the tendency of which was that of elevating while equalizing the condition of man throughout the world. Again, you can see the echoes of John Quincy Adams. This principle of justice, of true humanity, this is what's going to govern civilization on this planet, right? And what I want to focus in on is just a moment, an evening. It's one evening in 1869, but it gives you an insight into a real what's actually developing strategically in the planet. What you have is the wartime governor of Pennsylvania, Andrew Curtin, is being sent off to Russia to be the ambassador of the United States to Russia. So Carey organizes a grand farewell celebration in Philadelphia, right? And present is Jay Cook. Jay Cook was the mastermind of financing the Union through floating bonds. That's a whole story in and of itself, but he basically was able to outflank the control over British banking to ensure that we had what was required in terms of credit. And yes, Carey, just like Hugh Carey. Yeah, no, I didn't put it in there. So Cook is there. He is also the architect of the second Transcontinental Railroad, the Northern Pacific Railroad. All right, and he is sending agents around the world to raise money to do this, etc. Joshua Owen is the Civil War general who was commanded the famous Philadelphia Brigade. This is for Civil War fans, but anyway. And you had the entire Russian legation headed up by the ambassador to the United States, Konstantin Kazi. And the whole legation, the whole gang of Russians are all there at this thing, right? Now, what are they doing there? That's the first question you have to ask. And I want to read this because this is at some point, Owen, the general, gets up and gives a speech, and he says the following. And I want you to think about this. We stand on the shores of the Pacific and cast willful eyes over its expanse of waters to see if any kindred people will join us in girdling the globe with a tramway of iron. We have discovered that true glory is only to be obtained through the performance of great deeds, which tend to advance civilization and develop the material wealth of people. In pursuance of these noble objects, we have discarded war, although we had organized the greatest war power of ancient or modern times. Who are our natural allies in the old world in the prosecution of this grand design? Not the English, for they are commercial rivals. Not the French, for they're jealous of our democratic institutions. The Russians have become simultaneously with us the champions of freedom by emancipating their slaves, however much common origin, common language, religion, or some grand sentiment may unite peoples. The greatest bond is a community of interest, an identity of destiny. Let Tsar Alexander II construct a grand trunk railway from the Baltic to the Sea of Okhotsk of like gauge with our Pacific Transcontinental Railroad. And he will maintain his firm hold on his vast dominions and outflank the movement made by France and England for predominance in the east through the Suez Canal. And then America and Russia will dictate peace to the world. Now this is just a minor general that most people have never even heard of. That was Owen saying this. So this is a huge strategic factor in the planet that begins to come into being. So just keep that in mind, because we'll come back to some of that.
Wasn't it also important that Russia selling Alaska?
Yeah, absolutely. That's part of the picture. Yeah, absolutely part of the picture. That's in 1870. That's when the Northern Pacific is actually begun. And then we negotiate that. It's part of the whole picture. Yep. But anyway, this Russia thing did not start. Of course, what happened in October 63 is the Russian Navy, and they just had a big celebration of this last year. There were forums and conferences, et cetera. The Russian Navy, this is Alexander II. Here. He's the one that freed the serfs. Great admirer of Abraham Lincoln. So he sent the Russian Navy, such as it was. It wasn't the British Navy. This is not some huge power, right? This is not the Soviet Union or something, but it is a Navy. And he sent them into the ports of New York and into San Francisco. And what this was, the intention was, remember, this is Gettysburg, Vicksburg, it's all that summer, right? Meade screws up. We could have crushed the Confederacy. We don't. We have this horrifically prolonged war. There's tremendous pressure on Lincoln, right? And, you know, the British are threatening to send the Royal Navy in, French also, to start blockading northern cities and finish it off and get a negotiated settlement and finish the Union. So the Russians send their Navy over to San Francisco and New York, right, with the intention of telling the British and the French, we're going to weigh in. You send your Navy, you're going to take us on. You're at war with us, right? And this was not some small little thing. Pacific and the Atlantic, yeah. Both ports, in San Francisco and New York, yeah. That's the Russian Navy down there at the bottom. And then, can anybody guess where this is? Yeah. That's Trinity. It's Broadway. No, it's Trinity Church. This is a grand procession of the Russian. These are all the Russian military guys. So they were here for weeks. And you had all of these events and celebrations. So this was, New York City was swarming with Russians in 1863. So, okay, so that's one factor. Russia and the United States are going to dictate peace to the world. Then you have another critical factor, which is the new Germany, because there was no Germany until 1871. There was Prussia, these German states, but they were all part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And this fellow, Bismarck, really was the architect that pulled this together as a unified nation for the first time. And we'll come back to that. We'll look at a clip, which some of you have probably already seen but may have forgot about. But I also want to focus on this gentleman here who, going back to 1849, this is like a continuous process of the representatives of the representation of Germany into the United States. In various, remember, you know, you had Prussia, then you had German Empire, so the entities change. He was also directly, intimately involved with Jay Cook with the building of the Northern Pacific Railroad. And part of it is the land, you know, you had to settle people along these railroads, right? This is in the middle of nowhere, right? And part of it was a whole bunch of German immigrants were going to be brought over and given land. All right, now here's your quiz for the day. What's the capital of North Dakota? Hello? So they named a capital after him. And that's why it's named. It was a little hub in the railroad. So that factor, which we'll come back to and look at. And then you have something else, which is the beginning of something which those of us now 150 years later can appreciate even greater. But it's somewhat of an inversion of these two things I just identified. This is a book that was published, printed in 1870. And it was printed in tens of thousands of copies and read throughout the United States. It's I actually got a copy at one point. It's about a 500-page book. And it's all about China, everything you want to know about China. Food, the culture, Confucius, the history, the dynasties, the whole thing. It was written by one of these operatives of Quincy Adams and Company who had been a missionary in China. But look what he has as the quote on the cover page. Who does not see that henceforth every year European commerce, politics, thoughts, and activity, European activity, although actually gaining greater force and European connections and actually becoming more intimate, will nevertheless ultimately sink in importance, while the Pacific Ocean, its shores, its islands, and the vast regions beyond will become the chief theater of events of the worlds hereafter. And that's your friend there, Seward, who, of course, organized the purchase of Alaska. That he actually gave that speech in 1850 or something, way before the Civil War. But this comes out of a process which I've given whole presentations on, but I'll just identify it, somewhat of an inversion. What you had at the time that the British Empire was sponsoring the Confederate insurrection against the United States, they were doing a similar thing in China to just break the entire country up. It was called the Taiping Rebellion, and it was completely sponsored by British operatives. It was a wacko Christian cult, and it was a military conflict. And the problem is with China is that you had the dynasty, the Qing dynasty, the Manchus, was a foreign occupation itself from Manchuria. So it was a mess. And so what happened, this is the fun story, of course, this guy had gone over to, he's from New Jersey, from New Brunswick. David Abiel was a missionary who went over to China in the 1830s, and he met up with this guy, Xu Jiyu, who was an old traditional kind of Confucian scholar, Confucian nationalist is what I called them. And he gave this guy the briefing of the whole world, the American Revolution, and what had just occurred, and how we defeated the British Empire, and blah, 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 blah. And this guy put together the first atlas called A Brief Analysis of the World, which was a strategic atlas for Chinese people to see all the different countries and the states, et cetera. What's that? Yeah, that's India. That's right. But it's got everything. It's got a United States map with it, and they created Chinese names for the states and the whole thing. This is I think it's still there. This is the Washington Monument on the inside. So in 1850, 51, his grouping sent over a commemoration for the Washington Monument because once he learned about George Washington, this became his hero. And he writes this thing, George Washington, this is like, forget about our ancient leaders. This guy is, yeah, but you know what this guy did? He overthrew the British, and then he did this, and then he didn't even become king, you know. So what happened is that when they became under attack, I don't know, people may know him. This is Rong Hong or Yung Wing. Anybody ever heard of Yung Wing? He's the first Chinese to graduate from an American university. He graduated from Yale University. It's one of these waves of Chinese students that came over here. So this is Zeng Guofan, who is also allied with another guy I just showed you. He's a different person. But anyway, these are the Confucian nationalists who had to figure out how are we going to ward off this insurrection, stop China from being ripped apart. Our emperor is a nut job. You know, the court's corrupt. We have to do something. And so they had Yung Wing negotiate. He came over here during the American Civil War, right? And they went to Fitchburg, Springfield, Massachusetts. Was kind of like the core of the Civil War machine, tool, production, munitions, etc., right? And he bought a boatload of machinery to take back to China, and they set up something called the Jiangnan Arsenal, which is right in Shanghai at the mouth of the Yangtze River. And it wasn't just an arsenal. They could create munitions there. They had a polytechnic school. It was like West Point, basically. And this allowed the Chinese nationalists to mobilize a sufficient military force to drive back this Taiping revolt. So this is interesting, right? So this is in the middle of us being in the middle of, we're actually helping the Chinese preserve their nation, right? So this is the beginning of something, if you think about this, and I kind of begin to extend it through to now. So now all of this I just went through is before 1876, because a lot of people think of, wow, 1876, we had this big centennial, and then all these people came from around the world, and they said, golly, this is really great. No, that's not what happened. All these strategic processes were already in motion with Russia, with Germany, the Northern Pacific, with China, you know, and Japan. I didn't even talk about Japan, right? So by the time you had the 76 expedition, the centennial, the idea was to consolidate this and use this as a kind of an organizing, the way that we would use at an international conference or something. Except this is obviously much much grander scale. I'm not going to read through this, but this was a big fight to even have this, because the British agents didn't want, obviously, have even have this celebration, so they tried to stop it by denying the funding. But basically, this is a speech that was given on the floor of the Congress by William Pig Iron Kelly, the staunch Republican from Pennsylvania, where he just says, you know, we're holding this to show, you know, what immense progress has done in such a little teeny period of time with this form of government that we have, far superior than anything in London, Paris, etc. But what was the exhibition? You had a huge display by Baldwin locomotives on the power, the science, and technology of the locomotive and the steam engines. So, you know, people could come there and say, hey, we want to buy one of these, you know. This is a, I believe this is a blast furnace. That's the famous Corliss steam engine. I think probably at that point the largest, this is a big, huge steam engine. So you'd have this in the middle of somewhere, and all these belts and pulleys, you can run a whole factory of stuff with it, right? Remember, this is before electricity, all that's coming in. Yeah, that was the centerpiece of it. It was at the centennial, right? And this is just an overview. Yes, it was. Yeah, that was the center of, I think, the main pavilion was this huge machine. In fact, that's where they had the opening ceremonies. So, anyway, this is just to give you an idea. Look at this. This is Fairmount Park in Philadelphia, but it's like a whole city that's built for this. Look at these pavilions, right? Just extraordinary. This is the opening day. There was about 100,000 people there. I don't know if you can see this. You see that little man there? That's a conductor. They conducted a 1,000-person chorus, and they sang Handel's Messiah. We got to do that sometime. Just for the hell of it. Okay, so what you have roughly, and this is I'm giving general, but just to think about this in a certain strategic way. In this period coming out of the 1870s, 80s, into 1890, you have this strategic Eurasian alliance developing on the planet. That's what the red countries are, right? It's a Pacific-centered development. So Germany, you have Bismarck, von Geralt. Again, we'll come back to that in a second. Russia, Alexander II, Sergei Vita, who was the transport and finance minister, who was really the big promoter of the Trans-Siberian Railroad, along with Dmitry Mendeleev, which Americans were directly involved with, which did exactly what Joshua Owen was saying in 1869, right? I don't know if they made it the same gauge or not, actually, but Sadi Carnot, who's the president of France, and Anatole was the foreign minister. And Anatole had a whole plan for France to dump the idea of being a colonial empire and instead build all these internal rail lines in Africa to join up with the Eurasian system, which isn't on here, but that was the idea. Japan, this fellow Okubo was they didn't call it a finance minister, it was some other name like a home minister or an interior or something. He created with the Americans the first national bank in Japan in 1873, I believe. This was modeled explicitly on Hamilton's National Bank for the industrial development of Japan. China, we already talked about. You had these allies there. And then you had all sorts of things within the Americas. Benito Juarez, who was an ally of Lincoln, and also networks that continued there after the Civil War. There was extensive American Army Corps of Engineer guys going into Mexico, Colombia. We tried to get into Peru and Chile. We had networks there. It was a little bit more embattled. Rafael Nunez. This is probably the greatest pro-American Promethean in the Southern Hemisphere, in South America, who was the president of Colombia. So that's where we had the most extensive. But anyway, you get the picture. You get the global picture here. And, oh yeah, this is fun. This is 1890. This is a map. Everybody seen this thing before? It floats around a lot. This is called Gilpin's American Economic Just and Correct Map of the World. But notice it's Pacific centered, right? Isn't that interesting? And then he has this thing running through here called the Cosmopolitan Railroad. Obviously, it's highly schematic. But it goes around the whole planet. So it's Africa, Europe, it goes across Eurasia, you know, some kind of portage or bridge at the Bering Straits and down into South America. So this is the idea. This guy's a really interesting guy. He was the Civil War time governor of Colorado. And he was at total war with the Confederacy, believe it or not, out in Colorado. What's this? This? Yeah, well, the Russians that wanted to actually have a bridge there, they wanted to build a bridge. But anyway, we have to move on here. All right, so I want to just show this because it's a really good overview of Bismarck, but also the kind of the process of whole. This is from the documentary that we did some years ago, 2008, I guess, 1932. So some people may have already seen this, but it's worth looking at.
And in Germany, the American system reached its greatest application anywhere outside the United States through the actions of Chancellor Otto von Bismarck, who had been an ally of the American system from the days of his youth.
Bismarck himself had been a close friend of some of the American students who had been explicitly sent over by John Quincy Adams to study at Göttingen, at Jena, at Berlin, to basically study universal history as it was taught by Schiller and by the von Humboldts.
3 years after the American centennial, Bismarck broke Germany's free trade system, implementing an American-inspired tariff policy for Germany. The kinship between Germany and the U.S. became so strong at this time that Republican congressman and Civil War veteran William McKinley quoted Bismarck's speech for a German tariff from the floor of the U.S. Congress.
The success of the United States in material development is the most illustrious of modern time. The American nation has not only successfully borne and suppressed the most gigantic and expensive war of all history, but immediately afterward disbanded its army, found employment for all its soldiers and marines, paid off most of its debt, given labor and homes to all the unemployed of Europe as fast as they could arrive within its territory, and still by a system of taxation so indirect as not to be perceived, much less felt. Because it is my deliberate judgment that the prosperity of America is mainly due to its system of protective laws, I urge that Germany has now reached that point where it is necessary to imitate the tariff system of the United States.
Under this policy, just as had occurred in the United States, Germany emerged as a national power on the world stage. Bismarck's circles, in collusion with French industrialists, began planning rail links to the Trans-Siberian system of Russia and the construction of a Berlin to Baghdad rail system to create a new, previously non-existent trade route to all corners of the world. The threatened world leadership of the British East India Company based itself on a relationship between control of the world's sea routes and enforced underdevelopment of interior land masses. The acquisition of strategic naval ports, or choke points, marked here in red, was the pivot of the system. By controlling these ports and corresponding sea lanes, the British dominated trade, using colonies such as India or African nations as sources of cheap raw materials and slave labor. Other nations wishing to engage in the same geographical area would have to operate through the British. The transcontinental rail projects of the post-Civil War period, therefore, emphasizing interior development of land masses such as Lincoln's American Transcontinental, Sergei Witte's Trans-Siberian, and Bismarck's Berlin-Baghdad system, were a mortal threat to the historic maritime-based power of the British Empire.
We were aggressively promoting the American system, and the British at that point decided that the only thing that they could do to prevent the successful spread of the American system and the buildup of these rail connections and the land bridge across Eurasia was to blow up the world. Literally, they were losing the chess game badly, and so their only last option was to kick over the chessboard.
Under this geopolitical view, British imperial policy toward the end of the 19th century turned to the creation of a great world war, pivoted on pitting Russia and Germany against each other. The intention of this policy was not for any nation to come out as the victor, but rather for all nations involved to be destroyed. In Germany, Bismarck was conscious of this geopolitical strategy. In correspondence, he wrote about his nightmare of coalitions, that alliance of France, Russia, and Britain, which would encircle Germany and destroy her in war and economic ruin.
Bismarck was committed to alliances which allowed for Germany to develop, but he also understood that these alliances required the benefit of the other. That is, that the unification of Germany occurred in a war against France and Austria. But he was willing to form an alliance with Austria. He had his own alliance with France, because he realized that if he were at war with these countries, Germany wouldn't be able to develop. So his commitment to the Three Kaiser League, the alliance with Russia, the alliance with Austria, that wasn't popular with some of the smaller German states that were incorporated in Germany. But Bismarck's argument was that this policy created the best potential for Germany to develop its industry, to increase its markets, and to have peace.
He also negotiated with the Russian Tsar, secretly, behind the back of his own Kaiser, because the Kaiser was going to agree with the Kaiser of Austria, this old fart there, still the emperor, in a Balkan war. And the Balkan War involved Slavic peoples, which were part of the Orthodox Church network, as the Russians were part of the Orthodox network. So it was an attempt by the British to organize another religious war between Orthodox and others, as Western and Eastern Christianity. He knew you don't do that. So he entered into a secret agreement, he did, behind the back of his Kaiser, two Kaisers, the first Kaiser and the second one. Wilhelm I and Wilhelm II, who was a completely British fool, and said that he would sabotage any attempt to support Austria in a Balkan war. So as long as he was in power, the war couldn't go off, because the British plan was to have Russia and France attack Germany at the same time, and to use the Habsburg Balkan War as a trigger for that purpose. So no. Of sabotage it.
Bismarck's insight and diplomatic skill thwarted all British attempts to pit Germany against Russia in war. His understanding of how European powers were manipulated by the British, and his counter-policy of alliances with nations for peace, meant that for a British-orchestrated world war to succeed, Bismarck had to be eliminated.
So that gives you a good kind of overview. How much time do we have here? Oh, really? Oh, okay. Okay. Anyway, so this is Zeus incarnate. Yeah, Zeus incarnate. This is Edward the Seventh. Some people used to call him Edward the Caresser because of his proclivities. Well, what's the next one here? I guess I'll put this in. This is quite interesting the way this develops, because everybody knows Queen Victoria and Palmerston and, you know, Opium War and overthrow the United States with the Confederacy, etc. But the way it worked is that, of course, Prince Albert, the consort to Queen Victoria, dies in 1861. And she just goes bonkers. She just goes nuts. She just, she insists that every morning his laundry is done and like he's still there, you know. And she leaves. She moves 500 miles away to Balmoral Castle in Scotland. So she's not on the scene. So from 1861 until her death in 1901, the representative of the monarchy is Edward, the Prince of Wales, right? So he's there with all the machinations and the powers of Europe and the ambassador. Well, Victoria is, this is the big joke, right? They used to, the joke was, Queen Victoria was Mrs. John Brown. This is John Brown, her servant, who she just had continual affairs with, basically. That became her consort. This is just a lowly Scottish servant or something. But it's worse than that. There was an account in the local pharmacy for Victoria's drams of opium. So there was opium, there was, then she held all these seances to bring back the dead. I mean, this was just straight out of hell. So that's what Victoria's doing, you know, up in Balmoral Castle. So she's just the queen, but basically she's going to make certain decisions. But the guy on the scene, you know, who's doing all this is and this guy was, I'm not going to go through this. This guy, here's a later picture. That's Nicholas II. We'll come back to this. There's the old cow there, looking at. So this is just, yeah, a little flavor of this wonderful family here. This is Prince Eddie's kids, and it all. This is a big scandal in the 70s because all these guys came forward that this was actually the Jack the Ripper, which he probably was, right? So Edward, his son Eddie, they were all part of this. I hate to say homosexual cult because it's much worse than that. It's like the old Hellfire Clubs, right? Just orgies, the most depraved kind of activity. And of course, one of the theories was, well, the reason that Albert went out and killed all these British prostitutes is this was part of the cult's initiation. And so these are sick people, okay? Not the kind of people you want to live next door to, all right? But that is basically, this is Edward VII's view of the world. Bring out the most depraved thing. And so how do they therefore deal with what we just went through in terms of what's coming out strategically? And it's real simple. It's called kill, 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 kill. If it looks like Prometheus, kill it. We'll ask questions later. Okay? If it looks like Abraham Lincoln, kill it. And that's exactly what goes on from the Lincoln assassination in 1865. I want to especially focus on this period. This is the guy that set up the first Japanese national bank, right? Alexander II, the Lincoln ally, is killed in 1881. Within a few months, Garfield, who was threatening to, you know, carry out this great Eurasian strategic project, he's assassinated within a few months. Archduke of Austria, then a whole bunch of, Carnot is murdered in 1894, the other ally in France of this whole project. And then you have all these, the Minister of Spain, Empress of Austria, and then of course you have McKinley assassinated in 1901. Now you have to think about this, okay? I'll come back to that, yeah. Good question. But I want to highlight this because you have to think of what this is. 1865, 1901, okay, this is 35 years. This would be like from, you know, 1990 to now. Can you imagine from 1990 to now we had three presidents assassinated? Pretty traumatic, huh? And the point is, did anybody identify what the hell was going on as the process here? No. Henry Carey is dead by 1879. He dies of natural causes, right? Okay, now has anybody ever heard of this guy? Really? Okay. If you go to the Cooper Union to some leftist meeting, he's still well known among the kind of like radical lefty guys. Peter Kropotkin was an anarchist. But he was actually groomed by Edward and the oligarchy as the center of this apparatus, Murder Incorporated, that was involved in many of these assassinations, emphatically the McKinley assassination. But this guy was a botanist and he was an intellectual. He wrote all these philosophical treaties, etc. But when it came right down to it, their slogan was forget the books and the ideas, start throwing the bombs, you know. And this operated through this whole network of anarchists, people like Emma Goldman, right? And similar kind of terrorists. This is the beginning of the use of terrorism really as a political means of, you know, destroying your enemy, as by the oligarchy. So anyway, this is the pathway to world war. This is the way that it works. You take all of these, you remember the map that I showed with all these allies, and you just kill them and kill them and kill them. And of course, when you assassinate these kind of leaders, like with the Kennedy assassination, it's a little bit closer to us, so we have maybe some understanding of it, it's traumatic. Because the message is to anybody around them, you act that way, we're going to do the same thing to you, and there's not a damn thing you're going to do about it. So just like Diane was saying, just be practical. Just do the things you can do that you're not going to get killed by us doing. And so you completely decapitate the leadership. In the case of the Lord of the Flies here, what he did is he then groomed people that he knew he could psychologically manipulate. And he handpicked those people. So I just want to point out a couple one here. This is Nicholas II, who was, you know, Edward's project in Russia. Now, he, through Princess Alexandra, Edward's, whatever they call, wife, you know, princess, right? She was Danish. So he was actually related to Edward because he had Danish. I don't know the exact connection, but they were relatives. So Edward and Nicholas II. Anybody know who this is? This is what Linda was talking about, Kaiser Willy. This is the World War I era Kaiser. He's the one that dumped Bismarck. He was the oldest grandson of Queen Victoria. So he's Edward's nephew, right? So Edward was an absolute genius at manipulating these retards, right? Because that's what all you had to do. You had to get the German-British alliance against Germany, right? And that's what he did. And all these other people were part of that too. This is Clemenceau, who was the French revanchist. You know, we're going to get Germany for them, taking Alsace-Lorraine, punish them, you know. And this was deliberately promoted. This was not mainstream political movements in these countries. What? This is the one that's ultimately killed in the Russian Revolution. Is that what you mean? Yeah, yeah. The whole family's wiped out. He's the one that. Anyway. This is the Ernst Cassel, who was Edward. This is Delclassé, the French foreign minister. That's Clemenceau. This is Edward Grey. Father was Earl Grey. You can go see his name at any grocery store. It's probably doesn't even belong there. But, and this is Ivolsky, Alexander Ivolsky, who is a Slav Russian diplomat who was Edward's project. And these people, I mean, he uses everything, sex, perversions. I'm sure there's all sorts of things that we'll find out, we don't really want to find out about. But that's what you had. That's Delclassé. That's Kaiser Wilhelm II. Kaiser William. Anyway, but the coup de grace is, of course, the President of the United States, who with the assassination by this operation of McKinley, this absolute traitor whose uncle was the head of the Secret Service for the Confederacy. And Edward is really, really masterful in a series of correspondence with Theodore Roosevelt. You have to understand, we, you, and I are the representatives of the great Anglo-Saxon race. This is the virtue of civilization. Yada, yada. Now, he thought Teddy Roosevelt was a complete barbarian idiot. And there's letters you can see that Edward writes saying, he's a lunatic, right? This is everybody knows where this is, right? Yeah, so you have an Indian holding up his foot on one side and a black guy holding up his foot on the other side and Roosevelt riding on the horse, right? The Anglo-Saxon. And of course, he was a big promoter of eugenics. He had this big eugenics conference in Cold Spring Harbor. So anyway, I'm not sure. Actually, I don't know. No. He wasn't related to Edward VII. He was just Edward VII went out of his way to groom him and develop him as this kind of like, you know, fellow Anglo-Saxon warrior for the Anglo-Saxon race. And, you know, you can see how that would work. And, oh, my God, you know.
He wasn't.
Oh, you're talking about his uncle. Yeah, his uncle was the head of the Confederate Secret Service who were defected to, defected, ran away to England.
Rockefeller funded the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute of Eugenics in Germany.
Oh, yeah. Probably here in the United States, too. So. Okay, anyway. So, the point is, now, is there anybody around at this period saying, this is what's going on? No. Does anybody in the United States start screaming, saying, oh my God, this is, you know, maybe somebody did, but nobody of stature, certainly no leadership, no elected official, right? Nobody, nothing. Zero, right? That's later. Anyway. So this process of war just developed, and I'm not going to say anything about 1905 and the Russian-Japanese War and this and that and the nothing, because it doesn't matter. It could have taken a different little turn. It all would have been the same process, and this is what we've lived under for the last 100 years. And part of the dinner breaks here was, of course, you had the renewal of the American Promethean leadership with FDR, here shown at Yalta, who was convinced that Russia and the United States were going to have to dictate peace to the world, just to go back to our friend there, General Owen. And you have to think of this as one process. He dies. All this other garbage comes in again, Truman, the Cold War, Korea, you know, McCarthy. And then as part of the same kind of process, Kennedy, who was really part of the FDR, Lincoln, it's part of the same thing. And so what you had is a decision by, I call it Murder, Inc. Whoops. I call it Murder, Inc. Part 2. And they're probably worse than Edward, and he's really pretty bad, you know. So that's the, well, you know who that is. This is the Permindex. This is this international agency that was set up to kind of conduit these various different assassinations. But let's look at this for a minute. And it's very eerie. It's a little bit eerie because, you know, the Lincoln assassination, 1865 to 1914. And Kennedy assassination, 1963, 2014. I mean, it's somewhat eerie, right? Because with the Kennedy assassination, even before that, this is the wave of Zeusian slaughter, right? You know, from 1960 to 2000. You have Patrice Lumumba, who was a pro-development head of the Congo, you know, kind of reminiscent back of Sadi Carnot's ideas of the development of Africa. Enrico Mattei, who wanted to use the oil profits from Italy for the development of the Italy and for the development also of the countries that the poor countries in the Middle East. Then you had the Kennedy assassination in 63. President Diem of South Korea, Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy. So it's absolutely definitive. Don't do this. Anybody that begins to think of bringing back this Promethean project is dead. And all these people are part of it, are in some form trying to bring this back to life. Jürgen Pankow, Hans Martin Schleyer, who was an industrialist in Germany, Aldo Moro, President Ali Bhutto of Pakistan, pro-nuclear, wanted to have nuclear energy, you know, along the lines of Atoms for Peace in Pakistan. Sadat, 81, people forget all this, right? The Justice Minister of Colombia in 1984, do people remember that? This is someone that we were directly working with, Rodrigo Larrabanilla. And he said, we are going to eliminate the drug cartels in Colombia. We're going to wipe it out. And this is significant because of the history with this guy I was showing you before, Rafael Nunez, who was totally pro-American. And they killed him in 84. And don't you remember, within a few months, there was a military attack on the Justice Ministry in Colombia? Anybody remember this? They just wiped out the entire all the Supreme Court judges. They just murdered all of them, slaughtered them. Yeah, I don't, well, yeah, it was the, that's right. Anyway, Indira Gandhi, 1984.
Oh, yeah,
Herrhausen, who was a German banker in 89, who wanted to have a unified Germany under these principles of American system economics. Rajiv Gandhi, Indira Gandhi's son. You can watch the movie. Rabin, okay, 1995. And I put Diana in there because we think she was part of this assassin. I think she was part of this. What? I didn't put her in there. I'm not sure that was part of that exactly. There's, and this is just the highlights. There's all sorts of other people, but I don't know. But anyway, the point is that you have it's just a system. Now, here's the thing. Let's go back to this question. What is different, radically different, between that period from 1865 to 1901, 1908, and today? That's too general. You win the, what do they call that? You win the golden key or whatever they call that. Yeah, that is what's different. That is from this entire beginning of this process of Murder Incorporated II, starting in the 1960s, actually in LaRouche's case going back to 1946 when he was a soldier in India, that's kind of the beginning of it. What you've had is probably, in my view, the greatest American Promethean representative, because this is a universal genius. This is not just an American like Henry Carey, who's really, you know, got some insight into economy, but a grand strategist, a Prometheus grand strategist. Every step of the way from this interval of the 1970s through now, on the scene. And I'm just going to take a couple minutes, and I'm going to kind of finish with this. Because if you don't take this into account as a strategic factor, you're not going to understand anything, right? And you'll take yourself out, which is, I think, what these people do, that ask the stupid questions, the politicians. They just say, I'm just going to take myself out of history and do this little thing, and that's that. And, of course, that's how you get the world war, the nuclear annihilation. So anyway, so some people know some of the history of this, the actual dialogue with Russia, with the Russians goes back to the 70s with the pamphlet that LaRouche put out called the Sputnik of the 80s, which was the first idea of having a joint Russian-American project for these beam weapons. But again, this is just part of the continuation of Joshua Owens getting up saying, you know, we're going to Russian-American to dictate peace to the world. And then you had, after the fall of the Soviet Union, Lyndon could get inside Russia. You've had a just tremendous process that's developed, and this is why you have now Russia completely on this strategic American Prometheus path, right? So that's gone on for years and years. Yeah, and why they did in 90 in the Chechen terrorism, you know, and same thing with the Chechen terrorism and the soft underbelly of Russia, same thing. Germany. All right, now, if you haven't noticed, Lyndon LaRouche is married to someone named Helga Zepp LaRouche. And I have to say, there is no two people that have done more to reestablish the Promethean identity of Germany than these two people. With the work of the Schiller Institute, what we've done with all the history, you know, this stuff, right? And, you know, that's really blossomed. This is, of course, LaRouche's speech at the Kempinski Hotel in 1988, calling for the unification or forecasting the unification of Germany, right? And but it's not just Germany; it's France. All this work that we've done with Jacques Cheminade, the development of this Promethean faction in France, Eastern Europe. You see Poland here, Hungary. Tremendous work in Italy over years and years and years. China. This goes back actually to 1980 with the first trip of our people representing us to mainland China, and then Lyndon Helga's trip to Taiwan in 85, 88. And LaRouche has become really a central strategic factor. Anybody that's serious among the intellectual leadership of China, it just always consults mentally with LaRouche. That's the way it is, right? And of course, you see the results of that. But again, think of the terms of the long-term history. Go back to, you know, David Abiel from New Brunswick going over to China and meeting this Confucian guy and telling you about George Washington. India, that started in 1946 with what LaRouche did there in promoting independence, probably illegally because he was asked. He was still an active duty soldier. And they said, look, you're an American. Can you help us do this? Oh, yeah, sure, So. This is 82. Of course, Lynn and Helga were personal friends of Indira Gandhi. And Rajiv Gandhi was in a very advanced dialogue with us also. So, there you go. The Americas, Mexico, and Peru. I mean, it just goes on and on. This is all in-depth discussions on reviving these, interior development with the rail and the nuclear. And LaRouche was given the keys to the city of Sao Paulo. And I don't know when that was, several years ago. Not that long ago. Middle East, that goes back to the 70s. LaRouche was part of a process to get a Middle East peace. That's a meeting in 87 with the Prime Minister of Turkey, very public meeting. Right? Turkey's not it's a NATO country, it's not a small place, right? Some of the people, I'm going through this quickly, but it's just to kind of really drive the point home. This is Lynn and Helga's trip to Sudan in 1994, and then again, I guess it was in 1996. But remember, in the 70s, we had organized a conference on the industrial development of Africa. All right, I actually still have a copy of it. It's a blueprint. It's like the Eurasian Land Bridge Report. And where you would put the rail lines, where would you put the electricity, and the nuclear power plants, and the duplexes, and the whole thing. So what I want you to think about is the last 14 months. Because this whole process of 40 years has been solidified in this new paradigm process of these conferences starting in November of last year with the first conference in Germany. Remember, you had very high-level participation. You had the Iranian ambassador to Germany there, Lynn and Helga. Then many people here, probably most people, were at the event in New York at Riverside Church. You had the SDI conference. Again, reminding people of how this Promethean had pulled us from the brink of nuclear war, Lyndon LaRouche with the successful adopting of the SDI. You had the second Frankfurt conference in Germany that Diane was at, and then you had these extraordinary West Coast conferences. And I must say that Los Angeles conference, that last one, was extraordinary. And you had the first real Chinese government representatives speak publicly at one of these conferences. But you have to take the whole array of them. So this whole Promethean network has been pulled together, poised to strike for victory. And then, of course, you have the event last weekend with this, which really, I must say, is, I can't even talk about it. I'm so speechless about it, partly because I know what it's Boston and I know the history. And I know how the enemy is driven out, going back to what they did to destroy the Massachusetts Bay Colony, and we never got it back. And now we took it back, right? We crushed them, and they tried all sorts of things, and it's not going to work, right? So, now that's girdling the globe with the tramway of iron. See, there it is. What? Oh, yeah. That's the top-down approach, right? So this is where we are now. This is what we're poised to do. I just want to conclude with this. It'd be better to show a lot, but this is just a 4 or 5 minute section from the weekly report, which is quite inspiring.
The British Empire is faced with the fact that its present policy, if continued, is causing their entire region of the world that they immediately control and occupy to come into virtual extinction. A disintegration worse than that suffered by the Roman Empire in its collapse. As is typical of Zeusian formations such as that. But against this, you have the rise and consolidation of power. That is the power to produce, the power to live, the power to raise the standard of living, to achieve things on behalf of Earth. On the one side, the Eurasian sector dominates growth. On the other side, the British sector, including the victim, its victim, the United States, are dying. So therefore, this contrast between two nuclear-armed, thermonuclear-armed sectors of the planet, the conflict is such that the only way the British side, the Anglo-American side, transatlantic side, the only way it can survive in its present form, under its present conditions and policy, is to try to save its ass by going to a challenge of thermonuclear threats and even thermonuclear warfare on a planetary scale. This is the immediate strategic point of crisis of the planet's civilization. This is the only real strategy which defines what could happen. This is the only decision making which is worth anything now. This phenomenon which we have between the initiatives which are represented combined and respectively of Russia and China are now the core of this crisis. But we have to not only know this crisis, we have to speak of this crisis. It's not sufficient to speak of it, it's necessary to demonstrate the truth of it. And that's what I want for my organization, which I've been heading since 1971-72. I want that organization, which is my organization, get off the silly back and get back to business, our business. And our business is to be a factor of information and influence within our own nation and out beyond to save this nation of ours, these United States, from the piece of wreckage it's been transformed to by recent presidencies, and save civilization too. We are the United States. I represent the United States. You know, I don't have any efficient representative of the United States in power. I have people in the United States who represent important power inside the United States, but they're not in charge. They're only auxiliary. We want a presidency which is the leadership of the United States, not this garbage that's been foisted upon us by the British and by Wall Street. We want a real United States back again, of the type that was originally intended, with the original Constitution and the implications of that Constitution and its experience. And we in the United States must unite our people by whatever means we can accomplish to bring about a state where we, in the principle for which I'm fighting, as a leader within the United States, providing a political and related strategic role of leadership in the United States when other people who are strategic thinkers and patriots at the same time are able to congeal a leading force which takes over the direction of the policies, the strategic policies of our United States, not only strategic in a military sense, but in a general economic and social sense. We must bring about the kind of change in the course of civilization which has been the intention of humanity, the Promethean intention of humanity, which can crush the evil, the intrinsic evil of the contrary view, of the Zeusian view. That's my mission.
Okay. Questions, comments? Yes.
I have a question on, I know in past years, whenever LaRouche would make some inroad successes, they'd always, the oligarchy would trot out certain people and, you know, certain people would listen to him somewhat. Are there the same people around, or
I don't quite. You mean the oligarchy would?
They trot out these people down and say, "Oh, you did this, did that. Don't believe."
Oh, I see.
So what's he?
Well,
like Barney Frank would do something, but he's a nobody.
Yeah. Well, the part of this is generational. I mean, the reality is LaRouche has outlived a lot of these people, and. number one. And second, and it's a whole different generation. I mean, the, you know, anybody that organizes with us can tell you, our, you know, when we're out there organizing, the people that come up and sign up and contribute, et cetera, are between 21 and 39 years old for the most part. And they really don't like the baby boomer generation, which is all, where a lot of that came from. They're not really interested. If some boomer came along and said, "The Russians," they say, okay.
Uh-huh. Right. Boomer dropped the ball.
Yeah. So, because I think that's also a function of this continuous organizing process over the 40 years. So, you know, they tried that already. Been there, done that. It didn't work. We beat them. We beat them off on that with the attacks and the slanders, et cetera. You know, the Boston thing is a perfect example of that. I don't know if you're familiar or aware of it, but when we started organizing this, we were recruiting people to sing as the soloists. And one of the people that we recruited, you know, they was from Newburyport, you know, and they just got to her. And so they tried to start a whole campaign. LaRouche is a cult. Don't have anything to do with this event. They sent out gazillions of emails, and it just didn't work. Yeah, there's a couple things, but for the most part, no. I mean, 1,200 people were there. There were a few people, apparently a handful of people that came there, and they thought they were going to disrupt by walking out. Well, if you have 20 people in a cathedral full of 1,200 people, I mean, how much disruption are you going to have by walking? It doesn't do anything. So it didn't do anything, right?
Thanks for giving me that better seat.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. We've been waiting for you to walk out of here. So I think that's part of this whole question of what is radically different. You know, we, you know, LaRouche and people that are still with this movement have fought and won in a certain way.